if they're terrible leases.
Okay, everybody, we're going to start. This is a panel, obviously. We're going to do an update on Korean and Cold War POWs and MIAs, and I'm actually going to hand it off to Mr. Sauter here because he's better at introducing everybody than I am.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Nicolette. And before we start on the Korea Cold War issue, my research suggests that the POW issues are not separate, but they are connected, and they're connected, among other ways, by the Soviet intelligence organs, which perfected the exploitation of POWs with Germans and Japanese in World War II, and then taught the Chinese, Koreans, and Vietnamese how to do it to our American POWs. And very quickly, for those families and those interested in the Vietnam issue, there are printouts of a couple of new documents that have been declassified this year. This is the previously top secret history of U.S. Vietnam negotiations over POWs, which was produced for the Reagan White House. A lot of very interesting things happened in the Vietnam POW issue in the Reagan White House, including negotiations to purchase quote-unquote breathers, which were believed to be living American POWs. So this top secret report, which is called U.S. Vietnamese Talks on POW MIAs during the Nixon, Ford, and Carter administration, lays out what you all have been saying for 40 years about the connection between our POWs and the $3 billion plus that President Nixon secretly promised Vietnam and never paid them. So there are copies up here for that. One other Vietnam issue, the document that we've gotten out, and by the way, some of these are thanks to Roger Hall and his lawsuit, and John Clark, John and Roger. Roger, raise your hand, please. And John, please stand up. Where's John? Over here. All right. Have been suing the CIA for over 10 years, have done an incredible job, and some of these documents have come out of it. This one, just for people who follow the Vietnam POW issue, is something I've never seen before. It's the head of the CIA in 1985 asking the head of the DIA about the the capabilities of doing a covert action into Vietnam. So it must have been associated with some sort of rescue reconnaissance, which has essentially never been reported. This is not the Nam Rat raid. This is obviously something else. So Vietnam folks, you can grab those. Can we go to the next slide? So let's go to Korea and the Cold War, where really the method of the communists to keep our POWs was established. And I'm going to start by level setting everybody on what the Pentagon, how the Pentagon and U.S. government treats this issue. And just last night, I had the Pentagon DPA's official statement on all the major POW issues they emailed to me. If you want that, it's up here too. So there are a lot of words here, but I think it's important to level set what we should expect and what we've gotten now in more than 50 years of deceit and incompetence from the Pentagon on this issue. Right after the Korean War in 1953, General Mark Clark, who was the commander of all United Nations forces, he was the biggest general there was in the world and commanded our forces, the South Koreans, and those from more than 10 other allies. He signed the armistice, which halted the fighting, not a peace treaty. There was supposed to be a peace treaty later, which was never signed. And he told reporters, "We knew the Chinese and North Koreans refused to return all the prisoners they captured." In fact, he also told the media that he thought 1,000 Americans had been kept back by the communists. Quote, "There's no question in my mind that the communists still have some of them." This was publicly known. It was the public stance of the guy who had the best intelligence in the world. They kept our POWs. Not only that, they may have kept up to 1,000. A year after the war, this document, by the way, was only declassified in recent years. I found it in 2013. Nathan Twining, the famous chief of staff of the Air Force at the time, sent a memo classified to the CIA, and it said, "An apparently substantial number of U.S. military personnel captured in the course of the Korean War are still being held prisoners. Please help us rescue them." This was to the CIA. The CIA basically said, we don't have the capability to do that. The Army sent a similar letter. It's still classified to this day. These documents, by the way, are 6 years older than I am. So at the end of the war, there were hundreds of documents that John Zimmerman and I have showing why it was that the top generals said, they have our POWs. There was no doubt, just a huge volume of documents now, many declassified. They kept them secret for 40, 50 years. They still keep them secret from John and me. We were in the archives. But there's just no doubt they knew the Chinese, Soviets, and North Koreans kept our POWs. Now, flash forward to when a number of us got involved in the issue, the late 80s, early 90s, some of these documents started being declassified, saying, hey, guys, we're kept. So we went to the Pentagon, families and reporters such as myself. Here's what the guy who was in charge of the POW issue at the time said. There is no evidence to suggest that any U.S. personnel were not released from captivity in Korea. After the war, the top general said 1,000. Secret intelligence actually listed guys known alive. In one case, we're going to talk about it at the 5:30 panel. U.S. military was on the radio with Gilbert Ashley, a U.S. aviator, four other members of his crew, after the armistice was signed, saying, telling the communists, you have to give these people back. We know they're alive. You can't get away with it. They were never returned. So we know they had them alive, never returned them. As of 1989, the Pentagon had changed the whole line to saying there was no evidence any of that ever happened. I did some reports on the Korea POW issue saying that there was evidence that POWs had been kept. They sent this man, Rear Admiral Marriott, to Congress. He stated, no such evidence has ever surfaced. At that time, I had hundreds of pages of evidence declassified from the Pentagon and CIA that guys had been kept. He told Congress this, Congress believed him. They were able to keep this under control. Now, what do they say today? I don't know if any of you have read the work by Norm, read about Charlotte's brother, all the declassified documents, John's book that he and I did. Norm's going to talk later about many Soviet officers who came forward and told him that they sent POWs from Korea to Russia. These are the people who actually did it, told Norm, we sent pilots back. Hundreds more documents have come out showing this happened. Last night, the Pentagon sent me their new position. There is some movement here. It's not as bad as it seems. There is no substantiated evidence that this ever happened. Now, when we talked about Vietnam, they said there's no evidence, which is a lie. But for a Korean Cold War, they say there's no substantiated evidence. What does substantiated evidence mean? We're going to talk about that at 5:30, but essentially it's an Orwellian principle. The Pentagon will never get substantiated evidence, which is a living POW, or a video of living POWs, or a Russian admission from the KGB, because they don't try to get it. They don't try to get it, they don't have it. Never substantiated. Whatever happened to John's dad, Charlotte's brother, relatives of some of the rest of you, remains a mystery. No effective activities are being taken to do this. So whenever you see the Pentagon telling this, you just say, the general in charge at the time who had the intelligence said this happened. But by the 90s, it was embarrassing. It was too much trouble. It was easier to sweep it in the dustbin of history. So John Zimmerle, who's the best known expert on the Korean War cases, he's the guy you go to if your loved one is missing in Korea and gives you information the Pentagon will not give you, cannot give you, just put out a press release yesterday with Nicolette and Janella about a particularly horrific new finding he's had in his investigation, which is, you know, I hate to say that you've topped yourself with this one in terms of nauseating findings. So please go ahead.
I'm often asked where I find all this good information, this incredible information I find on the Korean War POW MIAs. And I can tell you that most of it has come from the National Archives. That's in College Park, Maryland. It's about 650 miles from where I live. It's only 25 miles from here and 25 miles from the DPA office. I spend a lot of time there. I don't think DPAA spends hardly any time there. And when they do, they're looking on specific cases, not general cases. They're not doing general research, which I think they should do. It's incredible how much information is in the National Archives about our missing men, and no one seems to care to go dig it up. With a few exceptions, Rob Rumsby in our crowd here is one of them, and he'll be speaking to it later. But my recent project has been a little bit different. It wouldn't have been possible without another researcher, John Eakin, who's been doing work on the World War II remains, or World War II missing, and he had sued our government for what we could call the X-Files. These are information on unidentified remains from World War II. He finally, after years and years and years of concentration on this, did get the X-Files on World War II. And miraculously, our government, or I should say typically our government, made another stupid mistake and not only sent him World War II files, but also the Korean War files, which he forwarded on to me. Now, I've been looking through those over the last couple of years. They vary in size from 2 or 3 pages to 90 pages, and they have a lot of good forensic information on the unidentified remains recovered from the Korean War. Most of them will reduce it down at least to race, height, and age. A number of them do have dental records as well. But it's in these X-Files, I have more than 1,000 of them from the Korean War, and I can tell you that 433 of them were actually buried in the punch bowl in Hawaii.
You're looking at right now, that's a picture of the punch bowl there.
Yeah,
on the slide.
Okay. But often these remains were recovered, but, well, let me say, in the X-Files, not only do they show the race, the height, and the approximate age, but they also normally indicate where the remains were found, the condition of the remains, and approximate death date of the remains. And then most of these X-Files actually create a chart in there of the units that were in that particular area around that particular time. And so what they pretty much said in these files is that in some cases there's 100, almost 200 candidates that could be associated with this X-File, this unidentified remains, just based on the fact that they were in that area at that time. But if you take that information and you start mixing it with the race and the height and the age, you can narrow it down. But what's also interesting is the part that they don't put much attention to, and that's this particular remain, A remains, was quite often recovered with 6 or 7 other remains, and over the years those were eventually identified. Well, as they were identified, they realized, okay, those 6 remains that were buried with this one, all 6 of them went missing either on July 19th or July 20th, 1953, from the 24th Division, 19th Regiment. So, rather than looking at 133 possibilities, if you just look at those two dates and that particular unit, now we're down to about 21 guys that are possible. And this is just common sense from somebody that has no forensic training. So if you take those 21 guys now, and then you look at the race, height, and age, quite often you can reduce it down to a handful of guys, especially if one is Negroid, 6 feet tall, and over 30 years of age, okay? It's one guy. And so what I found in this is that out of these thousands of cases, 433 of them buried in the punch bowl, of those 433, you can look instantly at those files and tell that it was narrowed down to just one guy. 116 out of the 780 cases there narrowed down to one guy. And I quite often had dental information and contacted the family, and there was no dental records to compare with, or the family didn't respond, or didn't get a hold of the family, or they had made a decision that it is this guy, and they passed their information on to the board, and they kept waiting for the board approval, and they would remind the board the next month, and the board still wouldn't report back and approve this case, and meanwhile, they had graves associated in the punch bowl ready to bury the unknowns. And so they finally get a message, okay, anybody that you've not got positive identity on and board approval, burying is an unknown. And that happened in 116 cases. These guys are in the graves in Hawaii, our government knew who they were, and never passed it on to the families. And a number of other cases.
Just stop right there, John. So think about this. He has files, and he sent this now to the families, that show either conclusively or a high likelihood that their loved ones have been buried in that cemetery for 50 years, and the government never told the families that this information existed. And he's now, John has sent it to more than 100 families, and I've seen the emails, they're coming back and they're obviously distraught. How could this be? Why didn't the Pentagon tell us? And if it was almost certainly my dad, or maybe it was, you know, one of two people, why didn't they exhume them and figure out who they are? And by the way, we asked the Pentagon this this week in terms of these responses. They didn't answer any of the questions about what John has found.
There's another half of the ones in the punch bowl that were actually did not have X files, unidentified remains files associated with them, but they came back in what was called Operation Glory. As he mentioned earlier, we had an armistice at the end of the war. It was not really the end of the war, so we couldn't go back in enemy territory and recover all the bodies that we knew were there. So the North Koreans started shipping our guys back to us, and we started shipping their guys back to them in an operation called Operation Glory. And so about 4,000 remains were exchanged. A number of those remains, most all of the remains, came back with a name and a service number on the box. But our forensic team decided it would be necessary to verify each one of those to make sure it was the guy, the name was on the box. And in 433 cases, they challenged that and said it was not the guy who was on the box. Okay, but these are remains that came back from prison camps. Now, oddly enough, 28 of those 433 are still labeled on DBMA's website today as killed in action or missing in action. Well, if it came back in Operation Glory from men who were POWs, their bodies were buried in POW camps, why aren't we at least putting those 28 names under the POW category rather than killed in action in MIA? So they're not even admitting that. And then we have a number of sets of remains. My notes trying to figure out exactly how many, I think it was 28, actually came back in Operation Glory with a name on them, but those people had already been sent home and another remains. Okay? That's what the notes say. They don't say whether it was correct that the body that they sent home a couple of years ago was correct. They just say his body has already been shipped home. So my question is it more likely he's the body that's in 1956 from Operation Glory, or is it more likely he was the body that was shipped home during the war? They never admit that. They just bury their mistakes.
So and your other research has shown the Karras files. John was leaked documents from the Pentagon, which had a number of people listed, and it said, wrong body sent home, question mark. So basically, we think that one of the reasons the Pentagon doesn't want to deal with John's findings is that they know they sent the wrong remains home. So when Joe Smith came home and Mrs. Smith and the family buried him, it wasn't Joe Smith at all. And we believe they have either proof or a strong indication of that, and to open this up would lead them to a nightmare.
And in 16 other cases, they identified a body back in 1954, decided it was not that body, so they excluded that name from that remains and reburied as an unknown. And then most recently, in the last 10 years, they've dug up that body and actually identified it as the guy they excluded 65 years ago. That's happened in 16 cases already, positively identified today, excluded. It was identified earlier, but excluded. So if that happened in 16 cases, how many more are those coming up? And there's been quite a few of them in the last 6 months. Now, I've also studied the reports that DPAA sends out currently of guys that are identified. And they say, well, this guy was on the battlefield, blah, 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 and he's MIA. And we had a team that went there in 2004 digging up remains, and today we've identified his body. Well, meanwhile, in all my research documents, I have four or five guys who were POWs who have positively identified that guy as a POW in a POW camp 200 miles away from the battlefield. So how did his body get out of the POW camp 200 miles south and in the battlefield? I can tell you quite simply. We were paying millions and millions of dollars to the North Koreans to do research, to send field teams out to the battlefields back in 2004 and earlier. And since we were paying them so much money to go to the battlefields, they made sure that we would find bodies. So they took the bodies out of the prison camps, buried them in the battlefields, and pointed where the guys were supposed to dig. Okay. And they don't want to admit that today. That's all I have. Any questions? Thank you.
Okay. Is that the hearing up on the hill there? Right, well, the year and a half ago. So when they tell the it would mean that they should cooperate with the private NGOs, mm-hmm. who are really the ones that are doing halfway decent work into it. Is DOD doing anything in cooperation with you besides taking credit for the remains you identified?
Well, they don't actually give me credit for the remains that I identified. But since we cannot go back into North Korea, the NGOs are not really working on the Korean War cases. They're doing a great job on World War II and some on that.
Okay. I think I can answer your question, Mike. And by the way, if you don't know it, the questioner here is a great American hero and someone I consider one of my heroes, Mike Bench, who was a returned Vietnam POW and received the highest award for civilian heroism from the United States government. So, Mike, it's always good to see you. So John has all this information the families don't have, and he had a lot of other type of information before this. John has asked the Pentagon, has said, I have a list. He has hundreds of names of families where he has information that pertain to their loved ones. And he has said, can you please give me the email of these people so I can send them the information, because the Pentagon doesn't have it. The Pentagon refuses to give John the information so he can send it to the families.
Under the McCain Act, by the way.
Right, under the McCain Act. And then, in addition, he has said to the Pentagon, okay, I will give you my entire database that he spent years and his own money.
Right.
I'll give it to you free. Just share it with the families. They refused. So they are actively keeping the families from getting this information. So maybe the media can help the families know that it's available from John. Thank you, John. Another round of applause for John. And Charlotte Mitnick, who has never given up in searching for her brother, who you can see, there's a slide, you can't see Charlotte here, but on the lower left side, you'll see a dashing guy in an Air Force uniform, and it's near a headline in the New York Times that says, U.S. says Soviet holds Americans of two lost planes. Now, Charlotte, the Pentagon says that there's no evidence any of this ever happened, even though the New York Times had a headline saying it happened back in the day. Did we just imagine all this?
Yes.
Can you get the microphone over here, please?
I'm sorry. Yes, that is very true. The government denied up until 1990 when the Russians came. They denied that my brother's plane was shot down. They told the family, and as I have here, that it was an air accident. And nobody, they knew nothing. And my dad did all kinds of research. He found nothing, and nothing really, and they gave us such baloney. And if you allow me, I can read and tell you the story of what had happened. And how people, not only my family, but other families have been treated throughout the years. If I can read this, because the light, then I'll try. I'm a sister, yes, as Mark had said, of an MIA from the Cold War. My father was in the service during the World War II. I have another brother that was killed on the battlefield in France in 1944, and my other brother served in Korea. I'm a proud, the reason I say this is I don't want you to think that I'm bitter, because I am. But anyhow, I'm a proud American, and I'm proud of my family and their service to our country. My family's paper chase started in the 50s with my dad. I know a little bit more now than he did back then, thanks to my friend Norman Cass. In 1999, memoirs of a Russian immigrant were passed on to the U.S. side of the Russian Joint Commission. Norm, at that time, was good enough to tell me about these memoirs and to show me, let me know, that my brother Sam's name was mentioned. My brother's name was mentioned in that of whose crew member. A direct quote from the memoirs about my brother and his crew member were as follows. But he did hear the names of two crew members of the aircraft, Bush and Moore, who will ever remain in the soil of Kabark, a region of Kabark. And however blasphemous this may appear to the uninformed, let people take my word. By their horrible fate, they were spared the vastness of the gulags. The Russians denied it, the contents, and they said it was a cowboy story. And it appeared to me that our U.S. side didn't pursue it any further. I believe Mr. Doden, who was the author of these memoirs, because in his story, he claims that he was on a Russian ship at the time of my brother's shootdown. He had heard that survivors were picked up by a Russian ship also. My family were told by people who were stationed in Japan at the time that they had heard on a radio broadcast that survivors of a B-29 were picked up by a Russian thaler. We were never told that by our government. It isn't easy to find words to express what has been in the hearts and the minds of my family and families of other thousands of POWs and MIAs from so many of our wars. For more than 65 years, we have worried about our loved ones, wondered if they were well, if they were alive, if they were ever coming home. Time after time, we have asked the government to help us with our search for the truth. And all that we have ever gotten were lies, half-truths, and misinformation. All that we have ever wanted was to know the fate of our loved ones. In August of 1944, one of my brothers, at the age of 21, was killed on the battlefield in France. He is now buried in Beverly National Cemetery in New Jersey. Upon hearing of his death, my family was devastated, but there was no uncertainty about his fate. He was dead, we mourned him, and that is the normal response. How can you mourn a POW or an MIA? You can't, you don't. What you do is you pray, you cry, you unite with others, you question, you become assertive, you become aggressive, and yes, sometimes you become obnoxious. You push your senators, you push your congressmen, and then when we the family members, start making progress in our search for our accounting, there is always something or someone that is preventing us to finding the truth. For example, in 1998, I FOIA'd for any and all of my brother Sam's files. The letter I received in a statement said that it was that my brother's files were buried in the fire in St. Louis in 1973. Well, I questioned them. I said, how can that be? I had asked the Air Force who had had it when they testified at a hearing conducted by Senator Schweiker of Pennsylvania in 1976. To make a long story short, I received a phone call from someone telling me that there was a vault that held classified files and I should investigate that. After many phone calls and many letters, I finally did get my brother's files. Why is it that our government is afraid to tell us what happened in the 50s and the 60s and the 70s? Why, after all this time, is this information on some of these past wars still classified? The question I put forth to you and to our government as well, what could be so sensitive after all these years? Why are the families being sent on such paper chases? Why are the families being given the runaround? What is our government trying to hide? Now they're telling us that there is no, that no one was taken to Russia. They say it doesn't appear that way. What baloney. Now, I have another word that begins with a B, but I promised my family I would be good. Why do we have to fight our own government to make them do what is the honorable and the morally correct thing to do? Yes, we are getting remains now. When was the last POW returned in recent years? Never. No one since 1970, or since the 70s. There is so much we the families need to know so our hearts and our minds can be put at ease after all these years. We need to have an accounting of our loved ones so that we and they can rest in peace. I know now is not the time because of all the problems our representatives are having with this administration, but when is it the right time? To quote Rosanna, Rosanna, Dana, or Gilman Radner, who would say, it's always something. As far back as President Truman, Eisenhower, Kennedy, Johnson, and all the administrations, past and present, this includes people like Brent Scowcroft, Colonel Philip Corso with his own admission, Henry Kissinger, Charles Trowbridge. I could go on and on. There are many naysayers, collaborators for no live prisoners left behind. They are the faint at heart who have said, we don't want to go to war over a handful of men. And that is a quote from President Eisenhower. They are the elected officials who once in office broke their promises when they made to the POW/MIA families that our government's number one priority is the missing. They are the cowards. They are the ones that are, that are afraid to speak out for our missing because it's not the politically correct thing to do. They are the ones who are afraid maybe of losing their job because security is more important to them for doing the honorable thing. And last but not least, they are the ones who just don't care. For so long, all we have ever wanted was the truth about our loved ones. And yes, we can handle the truth. We may not like it, but yes, we can handle it. For so long, we have everything that we ever wanted was the truth about our loved ones. And like I said, we can handle it. Over the years, the parents of the POW/MIAs, along with some of the wives, some of the children, some of the sisters and brothers, have passed without knowing the facts about their loved ones. Is that what you, our government, wants? Are you waiting for the families to die off so that nobody can hold your feet to the fire? Well, let me tell you something. That's not going to happen because there will always be relatives and people of honor who will continue to search for the truth and for closure. I have a message for the members of our government who put roadblocks in our way so that we cannot get closure. Remember, there is a higher being to whom you have to answer. It is not your leaders here on earth. If and when you arrive at the gates of heaven or wherever you will be, you will have men, thousands of men, standing there and saying to you, why did you forsake us? And what will your answer be? And at this time, I would like to read to you just a short poem. It's called We Remember Them. It's from the Gates of Prayer. In the rising of the sun and its going down, we remember them. In the blowing of the wind and the chill of winter, we remember them. In the opening of buds and in the rebirth of spring, we remember them. In the blueness of the sky and in the warmth of the summer, we remember them. In the rustling of the leaves and in the beauty of autumn, we remember them. In the beginning of the year and at its end, we remember them. We are weary, and when we are weary and need of strength, we remember them. When we are lost and sick at heart, we remember them. When we have joys we yearn to share, we remember them. When we have decisions that are difficult to make, we remember them. When we have achievements that were based on theirs, we remember them. As long as we live, they too will live. For now, they are a part of us, and we remember them. That's it.
I'm going to do what I do every year, which is set things up to make it as uncomfortable as possible for Norm Cass to do his talk here in a minute. Yeah. By showing some information that we have gotten recently on a case that you all may know about, which is the case of the infamous KGB defector Yuri Rasparov. And I'm going to keep this very quick because it's inside baseball, but we have this information for others. We've been suing the government, or we're thinking about suing the government for this case, and it may fall under the CIA lawsuit. So you're looking at a document, one of the ones that Charlotte was referring to. This is the evidence that doesn't exist, by the way, that you've just seen, which shows that a Soviet officer was in charge of the US POWs in Korea. And by the way, we're having a session about a new project we're doing for the POW issue today at 5:15, if any of you want to come back for that. So basically,